Mold us into a people who welcome your word and serve one another. Through Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham. And he said, here I am. He said, take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering, and he set out and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you. Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father Abraham, Father, and he said, here I am, my son. He said, the fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham said, God will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness or sanctification. For slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you then get from the things of which you now are ashamed? The end of those things is death, but you know that you have been free from sin and enslaved to God. The advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Where there is no hospitality, hospitality is that simple and yet absolutely that important. Now, isn't it strange that something so minuscule as kindness, something that I hope all of us were trained and raised up to show one another, something so mundane as that, offering a cup of water, how can that make such a difference? We often imagine that discipleship requires something huge of us, perhaps a sacrifice that we tremble and we hesitate to make. Now, granted, there are times that sacrifice is called for, but there are other times. There are nothing more than just hospitality is something that someone really needs. Now, we haven't had a drought in a while, and our pipes haven't been contaminated by deadly chemicals, so cool, clean water is plentiful, isn't it? We just turn on the spigot, and water comes out, we think nothing of it. But in Jesus' day, water could be quite scarce, so it isn't too hard for Jesus' followers to imagine what a pipe to encounter someone who has a genuine need, who really is thirsty, who needs a cool drink of water. I have to wonder then, if water is so plentiful for us, what might God be asking of us to share? What other things might people be thirsty for? Might someone be in a need for a hug, or perhaps longing for a kind word? Do you know of anyone who hungers for a listening ear or needs a shoulder to cry on? Is there someone you know who needs a ride to the doctor's office or to the grocery store? Is there someone around you who could use a nourishing meal? Perhaps you've heard the story of the Star Thrower by Warren Eisen. That story goes something like this. There once was an old man who used to go to the ocean to do his writing. He had a habit of walking on the beach before he began his work, and one day as he was walking along the shore, he looked down on the beach and he saw someone in the distance whose movements reminded him of someone dancing. So that intrigued the old man, so he decided to go see what this person was doing. As he got closer, he saw that it wasn't a young man, and he wasn't dancing at all, but rather he was reaching down, picking up something, and then gently throwing it into the ocean. The old man asked, "What are you doing?" The young man paused, he looked up and replied, and he said, "I'm throwing starfish into the ocean." "Why are you throwing starfish into the ocean?" the man asked. "Well, the sun is up, and the tide is starting to go out, and if I don't throw them back into the ocean, they're going to die." "But don't you realize that there are miles and miles of this beach and there are starfish everywhere? You can't possibly make a difference." The young man nodded his head as if he understood the old man's concern, and he picked up another starfish and threw it into the sea, and he said, "It made a difference for that one. It made a difference." Hospitality, welcome, concern, kindness, they may not seem like much. To someone else, it might make all the difference in the world. Consider what kindness might mean to a lesbian teenager who was recently kicked out of her home by her parents. Consider doing the jobs that none of us would want to do. Consider what serving as a reference might mean to someone who's looking for work, who doesn't quite have the interview skills to land a decent job. What do you think a helping hand might mean to a mother who's at her wit's end trying to care for her children? What might it mean to share a meal with a loner who is shy or introverted or a little bit awkward, perhaps lacking in social skills? It doesn't take much to be hospitable and accepting of other people. We don't have to be superheroes. Each of us can make a difference. Each of us can show just a little bit of kindness to someone in need. And the good news is that within those small deeds resides the essence of God. Hospitality, that's all it really takes for good news to be shared and experienced between two strangers. We never know which one of us might be the prophet that particular day. We might just be a prophet for them, or they might be a prophet for us. Now, you may know that for several years I've served as a hospital and a palliative care chaplain. One of the first things that a young chaplain or a green chaplain has to learn is that they don't go into the hospital room bringing cheer someone up. They don't go in there to bring a little bit of joy to someone who just learned that they have a terminal illness. That's the worst thing perhaps you can do. No, what the chaplain is trained to do is to enter that room without any agenda other than to simply listen, to simply be present to someone else. Learn to enter into a sacred space. And in doing so, if one is lucky, they might just have the opportunity to experience God's presence right there between you as a chaplain and the patient. Sisters and brothers, do you want to welcome Jesus into your midst? Do you want to have the blessing of a prophet? Want to participate in the reward of the prophet and all the righteous, beloved ones of God? Consider making one small difference to someone today or tomorrow. You don't have to go around assuming that it's your job to save the whole world. Simply just offer a little bit of compassion and concern. That's all it really takes. But I promise you, in that act, your actions have eternal consequences. And who knows? You might just bring a little slice of heaven to yourself or someone in need.
True God from true God, be and those who are traveling, Sylvia Levitz, Amy Kinslow, and Russ Kirkpatrick, and all those whose lives are linked with ours.
May we serve Christ and one another, and love us as he loves us.
We pray for those in need, especially those who are ill or recovering, Marissa Roblano, Ray Boyles, George Fadol, Ken Neil Rosario, Chloe Stockler-Easley and Penny Walker, Jerry Daly, Jonathan Longhead, Gary Alexander, and Herb and Ada Ballison. For Carla High and Rosalind Spade Carter, Janice West, Joseph Burpacki, and James Barenton. For Eden Burke and Jonathan Cantrell. For Chris Curtis and Steve Bradford, Mary Lynn Rulin and Sarah Beasley. Mike Fees, Carlene Sanchez, and Rosanna O'Brien. And for those in need of comfort or strength, Myrna Campbell, Peggy Byrd, Marie Weldon, Marlon and Alexis, Celeste, Steph and family, and Raul Daniel Rosario. God of hope, comfort and restore all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit.
May they know the power of your healing love.
Make us willing agents of your compassion.
Strengthen us as we share in making people whole.
We remember those who have died, especially Earl Wheeler, Jackie Hickey, and Kendall Simpkins. And for those who mourn, Matt Brooks, and the family and friends of Kendall Simpkins. And we give thanks for those who have died in the faith of Christ, and those whose faith is known to you alone.
O God, into your hands we commend them.
Give comfort to all who mourn. Bring them peace
in the time of loss.
We pray for ourselves and our ministries. God, you have called us to serve you.
Grant that we may walk in your presence, your love in our hearts, your truth in our minds, your strength in our wills, until at the end of our journey, we know the joy of our homecoming and the welcome from your embrace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
As members of the body of Christ, let us seek forgiveness for all we have done and have failed to do.
Holy Triune God, in our sinfulness we cry to you, seeking forgiveness for what we have done, our short-sightedness and our lack of concern for one another. Take away our guilt and cleanse our thoughts, that we might live in harmony and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. May the God of love and compassion forgive us our sins and draw us back into right relationship through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Please stand as you are. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us share with each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Thank you.
be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
God of mercy and grace, we praise and thank you in spirit and in truth, for you have asked everything of us, and at the same time, you have given us everything you ask of us. In Abraham, you called the people and invited them to entrust their future to you. In the sacrifice of Isaac and the provision of the ram, you foretold your gracious redemption of the world. You sent Jesus, your own lamb, as the new Isaac, the true offering, that we might belong to, in your company forever. In his death and resurrection, we know you to be the one who provides. Therefore, we lift our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven as we sing this hymn of an unending praise. Saint Jerome, Saint Mary, and all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, ye be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We thank you for your love and care in assuring us of your gift of eternal life and uniting us with the blessed company of all faithful people. Therefore, ever-living God, keep us steadfast in your holy fellowship. And now we offer ourselves, all that we have and all that we are, to serve you faithfully in the world through Jesus Christ our Redeemer, to whom with you in the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Please stand as you are able. God be with you.
And also with you.
May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds on the knowledge and love of God, and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen. Amen.